courses to in inside. Came president of
It gives all the annual 2021 Department of Commerce. A few years back, analysis of the central government and state government. This year, the analysis of the 2020. Let me introduce you all. Principal of College, Dr. Lucas Mabry, to the meeting is with us today and gives us a lot of welcome because he has been supportive to us in conducting throughout the past years. I welcome you to this meeting. I welcome you to the conversations of technology initiatives, organized, for the department. And also to the students and to the faculty. So I become very interested in this. The chief day of which is the office of the University of Kerala. He's a person who has knowledge in the area of behavioral science in international legal studies. It's here to welcome. Session with the analysis of the center on the Department of Commerce. I welcome all the teachers of the college participating, also the department of various colleges in and around the world, and also other parts of the country. Thank you and welcome to the webinar.
Thank you, Professor Nijin. Now it's time for introducing the chief guest. I request Lieutenant Professor Raisin Sam Raju, the head of the department, to introduce the speaker, Dr. Biju A.V.
Good morning, one and all. Respected Biju sir, Professor Nijin K. Matthew, and my colleagues, the teachers from various other departments, and my dear students. Today, I am very happy to introduce the main guest, especially the eminent guest, to you, Dr. Biju A.V. He is an assistant professor in the Department of Commerce, School of Business Management and Legal Studies, University of Kerala. I must say that he is a role model to all the assistant professors and also the students, because due to his good academic background and also his communication skills, etc. He completed the BCom, MCom, MBA, PhD, and also the LLB from University of Kerala. He also held a postdoctor fellowship. As you please note that he in commerce, there are only few professors who got the postdoctor fellowship, and our today's guest is one among them. He is dealing with the subjects behavioral finance, international economics, business analytics, security analysis and portfolio management, and derivatives. He has a spanning over a decade, he has varied teaching experience with participants at various levels such as undergraduates, postgraduate, who studied in various government colleges under the collegiate education. He is also a research guide in the Faculty of Commerce at University of Kerala and produced two theses, and four scholars are undergoing PhD under his guidance and supervision. He's an active researcher in the areas of finance, especially the behavioral finance and the stock market. He also actively involved in teaching, research, consultancy and training for some of the public and private entities. And he has attended numerous workshops, national and international conference delegations organized by the IIM and IIT, and actively contributed committees at various administrative levels. Other thing is that he's published 3 textbooks for the MCOM courses for the affiliated colleges in the University of Kerala and authored papers in journals having high impact factor and has acquired good citations. He also collaborated with the State Council of Education and Training for the preparation of modules for the teachers as well as the students for the higher secondary education. He is also acting as the resource person for the teachers' training practices run by the government missionary, such as the higher secondary education, vocational higher secondary education, ASAP, and other colleges across the states and other states. So we are very happy and very fortunate to get an eminent speaker like Biju sir for this today's function. So as an HOD of the Department of Commerce, Marthoma College, I warmly welcome Dr. Biju sir for the presentation. Thank you, sir.
Thank you, Raisan Sam Raju. Thank you for the good introduction. Good morning to you all. Am I audible right now?
Yes, sir, you're audible.
Okay. So, respected faculties and that of the Department of Commerce, my dear students, I think there are people from other colleges also. Hope so. So let us start the thing, the business. So the topic which was given to me is budget, decoding of budget 2021. So I will present my slides. The slide is visible?
Yes, sir, visible.
Okay. So the budget which was presented by the Finance Minister Nirmala Sitharaman February 1st. And so my purpose is to decode the budget. So it's not like the positives of the budget. I would say the negatives of the budget also. Means I will do like critical thinking of the budget. Okay, so some of my perceptions may be against your perception. So it's you should treat as it's my views. Okay, so I need to take a precaution on that. Some of my views may be biased. Okay, so Indian budget. As per the Constitution, Article 112 of the Constitution, the Union Government is empowered to present budget in the Parliament. And the budget states the expenditure income of 1 year period, one financial year, first, which will start from 1st April to 31st March. So it is an important tool for the government to sustainably use its scarce economic resources, and the government announces its plan for the next financial year. So the budget consists of changes of taxation, allocation of expenditure towards particular areas, etc. So the budget has two parts. The one part is economic survey that gives all the figures on government spending and income. And the remaining part of it tells what the government need to do in the coming year. So two parts. The economic survey was already completed, and after that the budget was announced. So this year budget is very, very important because this budget after pandemic. This is a situation which is very, very new to the history of Indian budget. So after a pandemic, the budget has been announced. And also the budget, you can interfere anytime during the session. So any clarifications I will give. First ever paperless budget in the budget history of budget. Okay, so this is the first paperless budget in the budget history of budget. That way it is very prominent. and it's allocated rupees 2,23,846 crore for health sector. So that is a very, very huge amount allocation to the health sector, and rupees 1.18 lakhs crores for infrastructure. Okay, it's road infrastructure, and 1,10,055 crores for railways, and more than 3 lakhs crore for power. And also, there is a disinvestment target. That is 1.75 lakhs crores. So we will explain all these things in the coming slides. So this year budget, you might have heard about that. It's a shift of political economy towards the right. And this is a budget which starts a new scenario of Indian economy, which shifts its political economy towards the right. And we are in a confusion that our economy is a mixed economy or a capitalist economy, right? So you know there are three economies, capitalist economy, mixed economy, and two economies. Three, capitalist, socialist, and mixed economy. Indian economy has been treated as a mixed economy, but right now we should think about that it's a mixed economy or it's going towards the capitalist economy. So this budget is a confusion with, it's a conflict between growth and inequality. So the budget stress for the growth, so that this much amount in infrastructure. A huge amount has been set apart for the infrastructure, but the budget avoided some rural development, agricultural and farming, and malnutrition. Some of the key areas were excluded, but this exclusion has a justification by the government. I will explain that. The budget purely targeted on growth. The growth is the main agenda for this budget. The country has to grow. The growth causes more inequality. So there are empirical studies which figured out there is a relationship between growth and inequality. So equality is the agenda which was given by the Indian Constitution. Over a period of time, we had budgets, and these budgets have given emphasis on the equality, means regional balanced development, balanced regional development. But this year's budget actually a shift from the existing style of budget. So this budget purely focuses on the growth, and the growth causes more inequality. That's the way in which the empirical studies seen. The growth makes the rich richer, but does it make the poor poorer? So that you can say that the growth makes rich richer, but does it make the poor poorer? So the studies, empirical studies, figure that the richer class will again be richer when the country grows. But what about the case of the poor class people? And right now we are witnessing our economy is in a V-shape recovery process, V-type recovery process. I will explain what is V-type recovery process. You might have experienced, or you might have heard about that, the V-type recovery process. So this is a V-shaped recovery. There was a rapid decline due to COVID pandemic, and the economy felt like a recession, and a sharp bottom level. We found that a sharp bottom level, and the economy after that, there is a rapid recovery. So the economy is moving like a V-shaped way. So many hope that these numbers recover and improve just as quickly as they fell. and we will look back at those key statistics and see a V shape. This is the most optimistic scenario of Indian economy. This was happened in many economies. Before that, the US economy, it was happened in V-shaped recovery. So this is a V-shaped recovery. And India's real GDP evolution over next 24 months. So there is a prediction. The India's economy moves like a V-shape. Okay, that the month-wise graph, you can see that. January, February, March, April, 20. Then after April, May, June, September, December. So it's increasing. So V-shaped recovery. There are many shaped recoveries. L-shaped, W-shaped, U-shaped, and J-shaped. But the V-shaped is a sharp recovery. You can see that. You can see V, U, W, and L. So the V shape is more sharp than the U shape, W shape, and L shape. So each type of recovery represents the general shape of the chart of economic metrics that gives the health of the economy. So there are indexes which promote the shaping of economy, like employment rates, gross domestic products, and industrial production. So V-shaped recovery can be thought of as a kind of best case scenario once economy has hit a recession. So this is a shape which is the best shape which can derive once the country went towards the recession. So this is an example of recession of 1953, which was happened in the US. And 1953, after 1953 is the sharp bottom level, and after that 1954, and it's like a V shape. So Indian economy is witnessing this V shape right now. So I don't know whether the indices are supporting this V shape. The employment is still in a pathetic condition, and the GDP rate is now decreasing trend, but the economy is moving upward. The main weakness or the main support factor of economy is the stock market hike. So I will explain that also in the later stage. So I would like to say the key highlights of this budget. The government bets on a real GDP growth of 10 to 10.5% in the coming years. So the real GDP growth that will be the expectation of the government, 10 to 10.5% in the coming year. And the government has spent huge amount for infrastructure. The main purpose of this infrastructure creation is creation of more jobs. I don't know whether the jobs will be created in the informal sector. There are informal sector. But the government planned to create jobs in the formal sector. But you should remember that there are informal sector which has been excluded from the job creation. Then high push for infrastructure and healthcare spending. So you know, rupees 35,000 crores for the COVID-19 vaccination program. That is very, very essential. That has been appreciated. Then rupees 2.23 lakhs crore budget outlay for the health. It's 137% rise over 2020-21. So now you can understand that a huge amount is spent for the health and well-being of the people. But you should remember that out of this budget, 35,000 crore which has been set apart for the COVID vaccination program, which is very essential in this pandemic days. So that we can have a conclusion that not much a hike which was witnessed in the budget for the health and well-being. Because due to COVID vaccination program, the major chunk of money which has been set apart for the COVID vaccination program, after that, so there is a usual thing which is being spent for the health and well-being of the people. And there are areas which was excluded. I said the malnutrition. So the latest recent surveys by the many organizations in India, India rural people still facing malnutrition issue. The FDA in the insurance sector will be raised to 74% from this 49%. So FDA in insurance sector raised. Then boost infrastructure. A new development financial institution has been set up. So you might have heard that our KIFBI. So KIFBI is the institution which is taking the responsibility of infrastructure of Kerala. So similarly, Kerala model, which was adopted in the central budget, and the central budget proposing a development financial institution, setting up of a development financial institution. The same like in our KIFBI model, there are recently there are criticisms, a criticism of our KIFBI model. You might have experienced that. But the same thing which has been repeated in the central budget, they are going to start a development financial institution. And I will explain this in the later stage. And there is another proposal, that is asset reconstruction firm, which is called as Bad Bank. The Bad Bank, the word Bad Bank is important, which will come up in your syllabus and curriculum in future times. So Bad Bank. Earlier you have heard that the asset securitization and a separate special work purpose vehicle, which was taken the responsibility of cleaning of bank's balance sheet. But this budget introduced a new concept called Bad Bank. The Bad Bank will be responsible for cleaning up of bank's balance sheet. The cleaning up of bank's balance sheet means there are NPAs in the bank balance sheet. So that should be cleaned. It has been cleaned by the Bad Bank. So along with that, rupees 20,000 crore has been earmarked for recapitalization of banks. So that is it's lower than the expectations. Now the banks are facing some crisis. So the government set apart rupees 20,000 crores has been earmarked for the recapitalization of banks. And another highlight, to reach the fiscal deficit level below 4.5% of GDP by 2025-26. So deficit, fiscal deficit need to be reduced. That is a good thing. So the government targeted by 2024-26, our deficit level should be below 4.5% of GDP. Then disinvestment is the main agenda. I said in the beginning, our economy is right now following a mixed economy system, but there is a confusion that I feeling like that our economy is moving towards the capitalist economy. So the capitalist economy, the moving towards capitalist economy means disinvestment. So what was targeted in the budget for disinvestment? The sale of two public sector banks. The sale of two public sector banks. How many public sector banks in the country? And out of the total public, 12 public sector banks right now. So out of the 12 public sector banks, the two will be sold out soon. And a general insurance company in 2021 and 22. So two banks and one general insurance company going to sell out. The government will sell stake in at least two public sector banks as a part of privatization plans in the next financial year. So that needs some legislative changes. That means the bill should be passed in the parliament for selling off two stakes of two public sector banks. That means these banks going to privatize. Sales of two public sector banks means these banks are public sector banks are to be changed into private sector through disinvestment. So the government expect to raise rupees 1 lakh crore from disinvestment in public sector banks and financial institutions in financial year 2022. So you will be witnessed in financial year 2022, two banks shares will be sold out in the market, and the government aims rupees 1 lakh crore from that disinvestment plan. 1 lakh crore. So that will be spent for the, this 1 lakh will be spent for the, spend for the infrastructure. So this is a chart which shows the government stake in public sector banks. So you can find that there are 12 public sector banks as per the statistics of December 31. Some of the banks recently merged, you might have experienced. State Bank of India subsidiaries all merged with State Bank of India. So right now 12 banks. And the stakes of the government also displaying here. So State Bank of India, the government having a share of 57.64, Canara Bank 69.33, Bank of Baroda 71.6, and the highest stake owned by the government, Indian Overseas Bank, is that is 95.84. You know, these highest stakes means the banks which are in the top level are now struggling. So I think the top level banks are going to privatize. The government planned that two banks are going to privatize, but the minister did not say the names of the bank. There are many people asking for which of the two banks are going to privatize. So there is a major question asked by the people, but they haven't decided it, I think so. So out of these 12 banks, two banks going to privatize. So you can think about the reason for the privatization. Is they really, really want it? Because the public sector banks are the banks which sells the schemes of the government. They are the sounds of the government. So there are mergers and acquisitions. After that, only 12 public sector banks still remaining to control the economy. But the public sector banks, the number of public sector banks are going to decrease. Earlier, we have 18, 20 public sector banks. Now it's 12. Again, 2022, it will be reduced to 10. So what will be the future of the banking system? So I said that this is a detailing slide of a setup of development financial institution. So India will set up a new development financial institution, which is called as National Bank for Financing Infrastructure and Development. And the name which was given is National Bank for Financing Infrastructure and Development. So similarly, something like KIFBI of our Kerala, the institution will be set up on a capital base of rupees 20,000 crore. And will have a lending target of rupees 5 lakh crore in 3 years. So that kind of huge capital-based institution is going to set up. It will be fully financed by the, funded by the central government. And the capital is being also provided by the government. And it has a lending target of 5 lakh crores in 3 years. A bill for the creation of development financial institution has already been listed in the ongoing parliament session. So in the coming parliament session, the bill will be passed. And the institution which act as a provider, enabler, and a catalyst for infrastructure financing, and as the principal financial institution and development bank for building, sustaining a supportive ecosystem across the life cycle of infrastructure projects. So the main aim of this institution is to support infrastructure. So there are proposals for direct tax proposals. The students who are studying tax may recollect from this budget. These very important points are interest on PF contributions over 2.5 lakhs to be taxed. So this is very important point. Interest on PF contributions over 2.5 lakhs to be taxed. So we had a situation that we can contribute any sum to the PF provident fund, and the amount contributed and I mean the principal amount of interest was exempted from income tax. That was the case earlier. But this budget, you know, the government charges tax of PF contribution and the interest if a particular party contribute more than 2.5 lakhs in a year, and the interest earning from the total amount will be taxed. So the government aim in the, this, there is a hidden agenda, the government channeling means if person like the richer people always invest in PF to reduce the tax because the interest income from the provident fund is exempted. It was exempted so that the people are interested to set apart funds in PF. But right now the government locked that plan. And this plan and this tax imposing aimed at channeling of funds towards the capital market. Then after this regulation, I mean the 2.5 lakhs are more than 2.5 lakhs to be taxed. The people may go for the capital market and invest money. They won't contribute in PF because it is been taxed. So also there was a tax exemption for unit linked insurance plans and the benefits derived from the ULIPs. That also taxed. More than 2.5 lakhs per year will be subject to capital gain tax. If any benefits from the ULIP scheme, more than 2.5 lakhs a year will be subject to capital gain tax. So the government wanted to spend, I mean, government wanted to channelize the funds in the capital market. The government is thinking to increase the index of capital market. That is the agenda. So the base growth index is Sensex and Nifty right now. However, tax exemption will remain for PF contribution is up to 2.5 lakhs. So up to 2.5 lakhs, tax exemption will be there. So a person who contributes, there is a reason given by the minister. Some people go to the extent of contributing 1 crore. There are people who contribute 1 crore each month to get the both tax concession and assured income is not comparable with the employee who earns rupees 2 lakhs and get 8% return. So that is correct. The minister is correct. The person who contribute 1 crore in PF and getting tax exemption is very, very cruel. I mean, very, very pathetic conditions. But there are people who contribute 2 lakhs in PF and get 8% return. That would be fair. So then the richer class should be taxed. So she implemented the provision interest on PF contributions over 2.5 lakhs to be taxed. So hope you are able to understand the things I am discussing. My voice is clear. Raisan, my voice is clear.
Yes, sir. Voice is clear, sir.
Yes, sir.
Okay. So there is a another most prominent provision because I am explaining the things which is necessary for the commerce and management curriculum only. Amalgamate market laws in the single code. Setting up of a single security market code. That's the main agenda of the government that has been executed through the budget. Setting up a single security, the last year we had a direct labor code which was passed by the parliament. And now this budget security market code which is going to establish by consolidating the provisions. Now we have 4 acts, SEBI's Act 92, the Depository Act 96 and Securities Contract Regulation Act 1956. And Government Securities Act 2007. And these 4 acts are to be combined together and there is a new act will be come up, and the amalgamated act is known as Securities Market Code. Understand? Security Market Code, this will come up. So after Security Market Code, there is no act for SEBI's Act, Depository Act, Securities Contract Regulation Act, Government Securities Act. These four acts are to be merged. And the government justified the reason for the Security Market Code: improves the ease of doing business in the financial market. So now, yesterday you have witnessed that India is the 7th position of the world capital market. India has got the 7th position. So India is growing, and India is a country which has been treated as a foreign direct investment hub of the world. Many foreign direct investors coming to India and invest because of the growth. So that will improve the foreign direct investments, we hope so. So that the Security Market Code, because the things will be like easy for capital mobilization and capital formation. Because now a company wanted to collect or mobilize capital, the company have to obey the four acts. SEBI's Act, they have to comply. Depository Act, they have to comply. And Securities Contract Regulation Act, they have to follow. And Government Securities Act. So now these four acts combine together and a new act, Securities Market Code, will be come into existence. And the introduction of an investor's charter. So that is a new introduction in this budget. Investor's charter, we know the citizen charter by the state government. So that citizen charter, that means the right of the citizens are reflected. So similarly, there is investor's charter, the right of all financial investors across all financial products. That has been getting clear through investor's charter. And I think that every financial company or banks will need to publish their investor's charter in their own website. That will be a new suggestion given in the budget, introduction of investor's charter. So this one you might have heard, that voluntary worker scrappage policy. So this is a long pending demand from the environmentalists. It is a well-deserved boost for the auto industry. Will encourage the fuel efficiency, environment friendly workers. So I don't want to say more about this. This is a new this system is commendable, I would say, like that, because the option of the person to do so. Okay, I don't know how it is executed by the government. And also jump in the allocation for MSME sector. Allocation to micro, small and medium enterprises to 15,700 crore. So MSME sector is going to be vibrant, because the allocation is very high. So it's better for the startups, student startup, etc. They will get finance from the government directly. So emergency credit line guarantee scheme means the new scheme which is been introduced in the budget, emergency credit line guarantee scheme for MSME sector. And also startups to get tax holiday till March 2022. So a startup, they don't want to pay, they are not required to pay tax till March 2022. That is a good provision for the budget towards the startups. Then exempted from capital gain tax. So if somebody invested in startups, and the amount of return from the startups shall be exempted from capital gain tax. That is also very important provision to promote startups. So many people will invest startup because the return from the startup will be exempted from tax. So it is very risky to invest in startup, because we cannot predict that the startup is going to success or failure. Sometimes the majority startups are going to be bubbled. So the government has given the provision, the return from the startup shall be exempted from income tax. So any amount of money we getting from the startup shall be exempted from income tax. So promote one-person companies by removing the limits on the paid-up capital and turnover. Earlier, there was a limit of paid-up capital and turnover for the one-man companies. So you might have heard that one-man company in 2013 Companies Act. So now the capital restrictions are also removed. So any person can start one-man companies, one-person companies. And they can allow you to change the type of company anytime. They can change the one-person company into a private limited company or a public limited company anytime. So that is a provision for this type of one-person company, startups, tax holidays for the startups, and the provision for the micro, small, and medium enterprises. And agricultural support, agricultural infrastructure and development says, that is the CES which has been introduced in the agricultural infrastructure. I mean, that the CES which is collected from these commodities will be going to the agricultural infrastructure facilities. The CES named as Agricultural Infrastructure and Development CES, AIDC. And the CES, which is the items such as petrol, diesel, apple, and alcohol. So rupees 2.5 for petrol and 4 for the diesel. That has been planned. So a separate CES for the agricultural infrastructure. That means the amount collected through this CES shall be utilized for the agricultural infrastructure development. So, for this CES, some kind of price hike may be expected for these commodities like petrol, diesel, apples, and alcohol. But the government planned the custom duty rate have been reduced because, in real effect, no price hike or price hike for petrol, diesel, apples, and alcohol for this kind of CES. So the customs duty charges for these products will be reduced in order to make an equality of price, and the government not wanted to increase the price of petrol and diesel, apples and alcohol for this price CES. So these amounts ensure enhanced remuneration to farmers. And this CES would be utilized to create agricultural infrastructure. And the one more point that is very important, this CES would go entirely to the center, not for the state. So this amount, like this CES collected, will fully utilized for the central government plans. But that is against the violation of fiscal federalism. We are the federal state, and the state, and there is a sharing between the state and central in the case of taxes. But these kind of new plans will come into existence in the present budget. It's the violation of fiscal federalism. So this kind of says fully utilized by the central government, and nothing will be allocated to the state government. So rural India is missing from the budget. 137% increase in health and well-being that already discussed. And allocation for the MGNREG Act, Mahatma Gandhi National Rural Employment Guarantee Act, stood at 73,000 crores. So this is again, this amount is stable. And I think this amount should be increased, should have to be increased. But no increase of MGNREG Act. You might have experienced this very, very relevant act, which is for the employment generation of the poor people. And even the finance minister's speech did not have a single mention of MGNREG. So this is a budget. This is a budget. This is the only one budget which did not speak about MGNREG. So the rural India is missing from the budget. So there is a criticism, there is a rural India is missing from the budget. Then the tax slabs unchanged. So tax slabs unchanged. The tax studying students may be happy because the slabs unchanged. And there is an important provision, those age 75 or above with only pension, interest, income need not file returns. The person who aged 75 or above and they're living with a pension and interest, they don't want to recur income tax returns. And their paying bank will deduct the necessary tax on their income. So these people, the senior citizens may be happy. They don't want to recur to file income tax returns. And there is a new provision, dispute resolution committee for small taxpayers is to be set up. So there are a lot of, disputes between the taxpayers and income tax authorities. So in order to resolve these issues, a dispute resolution committee, which should be started. Okay. So anyone with the taxable income up to 50 lakhs and a disputed income up to 10 lakhs shall be eligible to approach the committee. So anyone with a taxable income of 50 lakhs and a dispute, the person who has a dispute up to 10 lakhs shall go for this committee to get grievance redressal. Setting up of National Faceless Income Tax Appellate Tribunal Center. That is also very important. A national faceless, that means online redressal system. National Faceless Income Tax Appellate Tribunal Center. It's called as Turan Customs. Turan Customs. The Turan Customs means immediate settlement. So it's very, very fast settlement. And that also been started in this budget. So what for Kerala? Kerala is sufficient. Kerala is happy. Okay, I don't know if Kerala is happy or not. So there are three things. Allocation of fund for NH-66, Cochin Metro Rail Phase 2, modern fishing harbor in Kochi. The only three things for the Kerala. And there are shortages. There are no mention for the plantation sector. The plantation is very important in Kerala economy. But there is the central budget was silent for the plantation sector. So middle class Indians are in trouble. There is no direct support for the middle class. I already explained there is a lack of nutrition schemes. The recent survey which was reported that there are people which was suffering from malnutrition. So the middle class Indians, what would be the budget proposal for the middle class Indians? And I need to explain the bad bank concept. The bad bank concept, which is introduced to resolve non-performing assets. You know that Indian banks are now facing trouble with the non-performing assets or bad loans. So the government has proposed a bad bank structure to better manage non-performing loans. The bad banks means an asset reconstruction company, and they will clean the balance sheet of banks. So a bad bank essentially helps a bank clean up their balance sheets by transferring their non-performing loans to an entity structured as an asset manager or an asset reconstruction company, potentially helping improve credit flow to the economy. So bad loans of Indian banking system could jump sharply by September 2021, according to Reserve Bank of India estimates. So the bad loans means NPAs are going to jump, so that this provision was included in the budget, a bad bank concept. So the bad bank will take over the bad loans of banks. So this is a graph showing the NPA rise. The prediction of NPA 13.5% high. it's against Basel committee norms. So we are in a position to prevent NPAs very urgently, so that the budget announces this provision. So there are laws right now. We have insolvency, bankruptcy code, and the recovery tribunal are there. But these functions are limited to only a few large cases. So the bad bank could help in better bad loan resolution. So there are insolvency, bankruptcy code is there, and debt recovery tribunals are there. But their function is only going limited way. So that the government should interfere, or RBI should interfere the business of curbing of NPAs, so that a bad bank could help it better for bad loan resolution. So after budget, what happened? Investors richer by 10.5 trillion. So you might have experienced the stock market hike. So after the budget, the stock market went up, shoot up. So the investors in the country richer by 10.5 trillion after budget. So, and another question I have to raise, does the macroeconomic theories are wrong in India space? So right now, you know, India's GDP is now decreasing. Employment rate is decreasing. That means there is unemployment, but the capital market is going up. The Nifty and Sensex is going up. Are these stocks are going up without fundamental strength? I don't know. You have to check it. So the macroeconomic theories are saying like the country's development or the stock market index directly linked up with the GDP, employment, etc. But there is a problem with the GDP and employment. But the market is going up. So the macroeconomic theories are wrong in India's case. So GDP is decreasing, but the market is moving up, upward tremendously. So some academicians saying that India is in scissors crisis. The scissors crisis, which was happened in Soviet Union in 1922 to November 1923. So this is a graph of that time of Soviet Union, because the industrial retail prices are increasing, but the agricultural retail prices are decreasing. So the country in which industry is increasing in an increasing rate, but the agricultural sector or farming sector is decreasing. So I don't know, Indian economy is in scissors crisis, but there are people who saying that India is in scissors crisis. So after budget, going towards a capitalist economy, I already explained, the country is in scissors crisis at the moment. So widen the gap between the agriculture and industry. So the country, the government promoting industries only, they won't promote the agriculture because of the agriculture is in a pathetic situation. So don't want to take initiative to promote the agriculture. More emphasis on industry rather than agriculture. So India is the seventh biggest market. So that is a chart showing the India's position. The first one is US, then second one is China, Japan, Hong Kong, UK, and France, and India. So India's position was better. I think this better position may be due to the budget. The budget, the impact of budget in the Indian stock market. There are a lot of studies. Within 1 week, there were studies conducted, and it was found that impact of the budget has widely impacted for the stock market hike. So there are concerns. I would like to say that this is my concerns. I don't know, this is your concerns. How the government is mobilizing resources for spending? So there are a lot of fund set apart for the infrastructure development. So how the money collected, how do the money collected for this infrastructure development? So it is through disinvestments. So the government planned to collect funds which will be utilized for the infrastructure. The capital will be mobilized from the disinvestment. Is this being the right way to do it? So it was only in September 2019 that the government announced massive cut in corporate tax from 30% to 22%. So you witness that 2019 September, the government has decreased the corporate tax from 30% to 22%. This means 1.5 lakhs crores additional surplus in the corporates. And they were enjoying. In spite of taxing the highly profitable corporates, the government of India still wanted to mobilize resources by selling off public assets. The government did not try to increase the tax of corporates, but the government still wanted to mobilize the resources by selling off public assets, selling off public companies, selling off public sector banks, selling off public sector insurance companies. Okay. So privatization of nationalized banks will kill the banking system of the country. The nationalized banks are the sons of the governments and promotes the Jan Dhan Yojana and Mudra loans. But what happened, these banks going to privatize? If the banks are the main strong pillars for financial inclusion. But if this, you know, there are banks public sector and private sector banks, you might have heard that the only public sector banks are interested for the financial inclusion practices of RBI. We have private sector banks, they are not taking part of financial inclusion. But the government right now selling the public sector banks to the private sector, then what will be the future of financial inclusion? Or the financial inclusion was over. Concerns, allocation of agriculture is very less. Employment generation for the informal sector is less. Kerala plantation sector has neglected. Farmer subsidy is not proper. Indicators of budget is if the stock market up after the presentation of budget. It went up. The government planned to increase the stock market after the presentation of budget. That was happened. The government accomplished the targets. So purposefully stimulated the corporates for a stock market up. Revenue is going to fall. Lack of investment in agriculture. There is a big gap in the real economy and financial economy. You might have experienced. The financial economy is totally different from the real economy. Real economy is struggling, but the financial economy is growing. So there is a gap. There is a gap, or there is a conflict of real economy and financial economy. So are the financial economies fundamentally strong to this level? The study shows that premature infrastructure increased the growth of NPA. So there are studies which shows that premature infrastructure. Now the government is spending huge amount for infrastructure. Are these infrastructure funding or are these infrastructure projects will give the returns as expected? What happened if the infrastructure projects will not give returns as expected? This funded infrastructure project may be loss making and inability to service the debts. Then the projects are in trouble. So is there any thinking sufficient studies which has been done before this much spending towards the infrastructure? If a government plans to do this kind of infrastructure without proper planning and thinking, sometimes the infrastructure project may be a loss or flop, and this infrastructure project will not be able to repay the amount. So that will lead for the growth of NPA. So going towards a capitalist economy, capitalism is an open and free market economy. You know that. Socialist economy, you know that. The production, everything is state-owned. If we compare India with both systems, we find agriculture is in private hands. Labor is organized in certain sectors. Farm labor is largely unorganized. Banks are in public sector, which control 80% of the nation capital or savings. But a shift from the mixed system to the capitalist system now witness. In today also, somebody asked, what is the structure of Indian economy? I would say mixed economy, but the mixed economy status may be changed in future. So infrastructure matters. The finance minister's chief economic advisor, Krishnamurthy Subramanian, said an interview that higher capital spending will create jobs. Higher capital spending will create jobs. The best way to equip a person, and that an investment of 1 rupee in infrastructure adds 2.5 rupees to the economy. His findings is that the government invests 1 rupee in infrastructure, it will add 2.5 rupees to the economy. Compared with the slight loss from expenditures like direct cash payments. So growth lift all boats, income transfers do not so much. That means the government is not willing to transfer income to the people, but the government is interested to improve infrastructure. So there were direct transfers, means MGNREGA like plans are direct transfers to the people, but now the government focuses on growth and infrastructure. But there are criticisms. After the budget, this chart showing that budget revised estimate, then you can see that the increasing expenditure in farm sector till the financial year 2021. What the case of the budget revised estimate? Revised estimate is decreasing. That means financial year 2021, up to a particular level in which the increase in the amount of spend for farm sector, now the amount is decreasing. So revised estimate is very problem to the vulnerable groups of India. So health budget, you can see that there is a revised budget estimates. Revised estimates, it's decreasing. And the pension payment, you can experience that. It's decreasing. And education funds, it's decreasing. So this is the thing, expenditure on social welfare, which includes support for senior citizens, the destitute and widows, has suffered. That comes as a higher proportion of women that men saw job loss or salary cuts and carried the burden of unpaid care work at home. Lower caste suffered the largest relative fall in employment and faced discrimination when they returned to villages after losing job. But these are unprecedented times, and given the battering, the most vulnerable sections of the society have taken, they need more hand-holding and help. It is a worry that the government seems to have withdrawn its helping hand a bit early. Nothing has been given for informal sector employment. So I can go to the conclusion. It is a corporate friendly budget or not? This is you can say that. Cite the words of Michael Douglas Gordon in Wall Street. The growth is right, growth works, growth clarifies, growth captures the essence of evolutionary spirit. The growth for life, everybody lives for growth, growth for life, growth for money, growth for love, and growth for knowledge. So everyone is looking for the growth. The students are also looking for the growth in life. But this growth has the power of killing the mankind. Thank you. So anybody has questions, we can discuss.
സാർ ഒരു ഡൗട്ട് ചോദിച്ചോട്ടെ.
ബിക്കോസ് ദ ഓൺലി 5. യെസ് യെസ്.
ഈ കൂടുതൽ പൊതു സ്ഥാപനങ്ങൾ ഈ സ്വകാര്യവൽക്കരിക്കുന്നുണ്ടല്ലോ, അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ഈ ഇൻഷുറൻസ് കമ്പനികളായാലും ഈ മേഖലയിലടക്കം വിദേശ നിക്ഷേപം ഈ 49% നിന്ന് 74% വർദ്ധിപ്പിക്കുകയും ചെയ്യുന്നുണ്ട്. അതുപോലെ തന്നെ ഈ തൊഴിലുറപ്പ് പദ്ധതികളിലും വിഹിതം ഒരു 35% കുറയ്ക്കുന്നുണ്ടെന്ന് എന്നൊക്കെ കേട്ടു. ഇതെല്ലാം രാജ്യത്തിന് ഗുണകരമാണോ?
കറക്റ്റ്. അതാണ് ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞത്. ഗുണകരമാണോന്ന് വെച്ചാല് ഗവൺമെന്റിന്റെ പോളിസി, ഈ ഒരു പൊളിറ്റിക്കൽ ഷിഫ്റ്റ് ആണ് ഈ ബഡ്ജറ്റിൽ വരുന്നത്. പ്യുവർലി പൊളിറ്റിക്കൽ എക്കോണമി ഷിഫ്റ്റ് ടുവേർഡ്സ് ദ റൈറ്റ് സൈഡ്. ഇതുവരെ നമ്മൾ ഫോളോ ചെയ്തിരുന്ന ഇക്വാലിറ്റി പ്രിൻസിപ്പിൾ അനുസരിച്ച് പുവർ ആൾക്കാരെ സമൂഹത്തിന്റെ മുകൾ തട്ടിലോട്ട് കൊണ്ടുവരിക എന്നുള്ളതാണ്. അപ്പൊ അതിന് അഗൈൻസ്റ്റ് ആയിട്ട് ഗവൺമെന്റ് നൗ ഫോക്കസിങ് ഫോർ ദ ഇൻഫ്രാസ്ട്രക്ചർ റാദർ ദാൻ ദ റൂറൽ ഡെവലപ്മെന്റ്. അപ്പൊ അങ്ങനെ വരുമ്പോൾ ഉള്ള ഷിഫ്റ്റ് സംഭവിക്കുന്നത്. അപ്പോ നേരത്തെ ഞാൻ പറഞ്ഞല്ലോ, ഫിനാൻസ് മിനിസ്റ്ററുടെ എക്കണോമിക് അഡ്വൈസർ പറഞ്ഞു, നമ്മൾ 1 രൂപ ഇൻഫ്രാസ്ട്രക്ചർ കൊണ്ടുവന്നാൽ അത് 2.5 രൂപീസ് ആയിട്ട് നമുക്ക് തിരിച്ചു കിട്ടും എന്നാണ് പറയുന്നത്. അതുകൊണ്ട് ഡയറക്റ്റ് ക്യാഷ് ട്രാൻസ്ഫറിലെ കാര്യമില്ല, ഇങ്ങനെയാണ് കൺട്രി ഡെവലപ്പ് ചെയ്യേണ്ടതെന്നാണ് പറയുന്നത്. ബജറ്റ് ഇൻഫ്രാസ്ട്രക്ചറിലൂടെ രാജ്യം ഡെവലപ്പ് ചെയ്യും, ഗ്രോത്തിലൂടെ രാജ്യം ഡെവലപ്പ് ചെയ്യും. സോ ദാറ്റ്സ് എ ബിഗ് ഷിഫ്റ്റ് ഇൻ ദ പോളിസി ചേഞ്ചസ് ഇൻ ദിസ് ബജറ്റ്. You can criticize that. It's my opinion, it's not fair. Because there are people, vulnerable people in the country. So their development is also a matter for the development of the country. Growth, there is also studies, empirical studies, which saying that there's the opposite relationship between growth and equality. If the growth is increases, equality will be reduced. So that empirical studies shown the path there is an opposite relationship between growth and equality. The growth will improve, growth increases inequality. That means the richer people will become richer and richer, and the poor people will be poorer. That is the result of growth.
Thank you, sir.
Okay. Any more questions? Yes, please ask any more questions. You are following me, or I don't know, you know, understand all the concepts discussed here. So the group consists of MCOM and BCOM students, right?
No, sir. MA Economics and BCOM students, sir.
MA Economics and BCOM students. So you, MA Economics, are you going to ask? Are you going to ask Economics people?
Adhe, sir, adhe.
അവരാ പഠിച്ചിട്ടുള്ള സിസേഴ്സ് ക്രൈസിസും വി ഷേപ്പ് കർവും ഒക്കെ. നമുക്ക് നമ്മുടെ കരിക്കുലം അറിയില്ല.
അതെ, അവരാണ് കൂടുതൽ ഡിഗ്രി.
അതെ അതെ. Okay, if no question, then we can conclude. Because NP would have a pre-submission here now. I mean, I
think we can go. Okay. What of thanks, like, one, sir?
Okay.
I request Mr. Noel Simon Roy to deliver the word of thanks.
Okay. Good morning, everyone. Head of the department, Lieutenant Raisam Sam Raju, our chief guest, Dr. Biju Evi, Department of Commerce, University of Kerala, Commerce Association President, Professor Nijin K. Matthew, and Jumez and dear students. It is essential for us to know about, or as an Indian citizen or as a commerce student, it is very essential for us to have a better knowledge about our country's union budget. In this context, we are organizing budget analysis talks in the name Bud Talk since 2017. This year, we got a very prominent personality to conduct our Bud Talk. Sir, your talk was very informative and useful. I extend our sincere gratitude to Dr. Biju Evi for giving us such an awesome talk. On this occasion, I would like to thank our head of the department, Raisan sir. Every year, he makes sure that the budget talk is being conducted without failure. And sir, thank you for your leadership. I would like to thank Nijin sir, our Commerce Association president and coordinator of this budget analysis talk. Thank you, sir, for organizing a very useful event. I would like to thank Anjumis for combining, and I thank each and every students and faculties who have attended the meeting and made this event a success. Once again, I thank everyone. Thank you all.
The program thank has
you,
come to an end.
Thank you, Raisan Sam, for inviting me. Thank you, Professor Nijin Matthew. Thank you, Anju Mariam John. Thank you all. Thank you, students. Thank you for patiently listening to my session.
Okay. Thank you, sir. Thank you all for your participation. Thank you. The program has come to an end. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Raisan.
Thank you.
Yeah. Sorry.
Gracias.